Good evening to everyone. We're 1 week before Chag Shavuot, the festival of the giving of the Torah, receiving of the Torah. We should all merit to receive the Torah b'simcha, with the mute, with joy, and to internalize the Torah into our hearts, into our being, our very being. Chazal, the sages, teach us that the Torah was given originally on, it was Shabbos. The day of the giving of the Torah was Shabbos. That year, the year 2448, the year of Yetziat Mitzrayim, the exodus from Egypt and the giving of the Torah, so Rosh Chodesh Nisan fell on Thursday, so Pesach also, the first day of Pesach, which was the Exodus itself, was Thursday. And if we make a simple calculation from the Thursday of the Exodus to the giving of the Torah, so actually it's not just counting 50 days of the Sefirat Ha'omer, the counting of the Omer, which began on the day after the Exodus, the 16th of Nisan, the Exodus of the 15th, and then the 16th is the first day of the Shira, the day that we bring a korban, a sacrifice of the Omer, and then we count for 50 days. But actually the calculation comes out that on that year, the giving of the Torah is actually the 51st day. There are two opinions of the sages of what day of the month of Sivan the Torah was given. If it was the 6th of Sivan, that's what Rabbanan the Chachamim, the sages say, or Rabbi Yossi, his opinion is that Moshe added an additional day, and the giving of the Torah was on the 7th of Sivan. But as we said before, the Chazal teach us that according to both opinions, it fell on a Shabbat. How is that possible? It's because the question is, was the month of the Iyar, the second month, was it a full month of 30 days? Or, as now in the calendar, in the Jewish calendar, the month of the Iyar is always a month of 29 days, not of 30 days. So if it was 29 days, then the giving of the Torah was actually in the 7th of the Sivan. If it's 30 days, as at that time the month was sanctified according to the seeing of the new moon, and it could either be 29 days or 30 days. If it was 30 days, so the Torah was given on the 6th of Sivan, which is the date now of Shavuot. But the date now that we celebrate Shavuot on the 6th of Sivan is after 29, the month of Iyar only being 29 days. So actually it's the 50th day from the beginning of the counting of the Omer. But at that year, according to both opinions, it was actually the 51st day. But according to both opinions, it fell on the day of Shabbat. It's something special that the Torah belongs and relates in essence to Shabbat. What is Shabbat? Shabbat is Menucha. Shabbat is rest. Shabbat is the day that after the 6 days of work and even the 6 days that Hashem himself with his sayings, with the 10 sayings of creation, his melacha, his activity and work was to create the world in 6 days. Then it says in the Torah that on the 7th day, the day of Shabbat, he rested. Rested means that all of the energy, all of the divine energy of creation ascends back to its source. That's the significance of the meaning of the resting of the Creator on the state, that rest, pertains especially to the giving of the Torah. That the Torah also is given to us in order that we unite with Hashem's, with God's will in the Torah and the mitzvot, the commandments of the Torah, but that it, we perform it in a Shabbistic way, in a way of tranquility, of rest, of goodness, of feeling good, not being in any way stressed. God does not want us to experience stress in our fulfillment of His will. He wants us to be Shabbistic, that the whole Torah is Shabbos. The Rebbe, the Lubavitcher Rebbe, made a very great emphasis on this point, the point that the Torah is intended to be performed in a state of tranquility, a state of rest. Actually, this is the way that the Sefer HaTanya begins. The Sefer HaTanya, which is the classic, it's called the written Torah of Hasidut, the first Rebbe of Chabad, as we know. So in the introduction to the book, he says that the purpose and the intention of this book is Kivahem Yimitzan Margoa Nasho, that the teachings of the inner dimension of the Torah, the divinity incorporated in the Torah, this teaching will bring us to a state of tranquility, of Margoa, of rest, of Shabbos. So we see the Torah and Shabbos go together. The gematria, the two words, both words are a multiple of 13. 13 is a very important special number in the Torah, the 13 principles of mercy, the 13 inner properties and faculties of the soul, and many, many other things in Kabbalah and Hasidut that are 13. So numbers that are multiples of 13 have this property of 13-ness to them. Both words Torah and Shabbos are multiples of 13. Torah is 47 times 13, 611. It's 13 times 47. 47 is the word bitul, selflessness. 13 is also the value of both of the word echad, one, and the word ahava, love. So actually the Torah is love times selflessness, which in itself is a very deep and significant teaching of what the Torah is for. Shabbos is 54 times 13. So together, actually, the two words, if we say that Torah and Shabbos go together, so the two words equal 101. 47 plus 54 is 101. 101 times 13, which is actually 1313. If we write it as a number, it's 1313. And as a phrase in the Torah, that number, the most important phrase that equals that number, 1313, is Tchiyat HaMeitim, the resurrection of the dead. It says that Hashem will resurrect the dead with the Tau, with the dew of the Torah. And the dew of the Torah is the spiritual descent of the manna, which even physically did not fall on Shabbos, but spiritually it did descend from its divine source. Daska, especially on Shabbos. So there's something about Shabbos and the giving of the Torah that says that every word that we heard of the Ten Commandments, we all have to be present at the reading of the Torah on Chag Shavuot, to receive the Torah anew every year. At the year, the the reading of the Ten Commandments. And it says that every word that we heard, we actually died. What does it mean that we died? That the soul ascended. And we said the Shabbat is the ascent of all of the spiritual and divine energy. So our souls, the revelation was so great that the soul ascended to its source in heaven, and the body, as it were, died. But spontaneously, instantaneously, Hashem revived and resurrected us with the dew that in the future will be the dew of Tchiyat HaMitim, of the resurrection of all of the souls, all of the descended souls, all of the deceased souls of the world from heaven and on from the beginning to the time of Mashiach. I said, all of this is a teaching about the relationship, the essential relationship between the Torah and the rest of Shabbat, the tranquility, the spiritual experience of being together, represent together with God, the giver of the Torah. That's why actually the day of Shavuot is either called the giving of the Torah, it's called the receiving of the Torah, because the giving and the receiving become one experience. That we're absolutely together. The receiver is absolutely together with the giver. And that itself is the rest and the tranquility, the serenity of the Torah. That's what Hashem wants from us. Now today is the first day of the seventh week of the counting of the Omer. We said that originally, in that original year, according to both opinions of the Chachamim, the sages, and the Rabbi Yossi, the Torah was actually given on the 51st day from the beginning of the counting of the Omer. If we count from Chag HaPesach, from Pesach itself, so there, in that year, there were 52 days, which is two times Hashem's name, Havai, two times 26. Before the 13 principles of mercy, there are two names of Hashem. One name is the revelation of the infinity of Hashem before the initial contraction to create the world. And the second name is the revelation of Hashem, essentially above time and space, but descending and permeating time and space after, it seems. Those are the two names of Hashem. It's 50 equals 52. Those are actually the 52 days, counting the festival of Pesach, the original Exodus from Egypt, until the giving of the original giving of the Torah in that year, 2448, from creation. But once more, from the counting of the Omer, it says in the Torah that we count 50 days. Actually, we count only 49 days, which is 7 times 7. The 50 days is counted by itself. Counted by itself means that we achieve such a state of rest that it happens by itself. We don't have to do anything. We don't have to open our mouth and express with our lips and the other origins of speech in the mouth. It's counted from about the 50th day. But that year it was actually 51 days. 51 is 3 times 12, 3 times 17. 51. What does that teach us? The sages say, and we probably all know the phrase, Ein Tov Ela Torah, there's no goodness in the world except the Torah is the ultimate good. Sometimes we find the expression that there are two goods. Like on the third day of creation, the word good, that Hashem saw what he created to be good, that goodness appears two times, Yom Shavuot Tavu Kito. That's interpreted to be that it's good for heaven and good for people. It's good above and it's good below. But there's something about the giving of the Torah that the Torah is essentially good, and it's actually three goods. Three in the Torah is chazakah. It means it's a firm, well-established state, eternal state of goodness. What are the three goods? And actually, there are two interpretations. One interpretation of the three goods is that it's good for heaven, and it's good for Hashem, it's good for people, for other people. It's also good for me, myself. It's good for oneself. One has to know that Tov li Torah picha, Yafei zahav ha-chesed, that Torah is good for me more than all of the gold and silver in the world. Tov li, it's good for me. So actually, Torah is good for God, and it's good for everyone, for other people. A person says, of course, he thinks of the other one before he thinks and considers his own good. But even though he begins with wanting to be good and to do good for the other, it's important that he knows that it's also good for him. It's good for me. It's good for all of us, for all three of us. That's one interpretation of the three goods of the number 51. Another interpretation is that in the soul itself, there are three levels, and actually it's three different idioms that appear explicitly in the Torah. One idiom is Sechel Tov. Sechel, the person Proverbs reads, Sechel Tov Yiten Chen. If a person has good intelligence, goodly intelligence, that gives him grace. Sechel Tov Yiten Chen. So there's one very important idiom that one's mind, one's sechel, one's intelligence has to be goodly, good intelligence. The most important seat of goodness in the soul of the heart. That's why there are many, many times in the Torah, both the written Torah and the oral Torah, that we find the expression a good heart. We have to strive, time to strive for a good heart. It says in Pirkei Avot and the ethics of the fathers that the most all-inclusive good property, good way that a person has to choose in his life and follow in his life is the good heart. That expression, good heart, is equals 49. That's also one of the interpretations, the meanings of the 49 days of the counting of the Omer to achieve by rectifying all of the seven attributes of the heart, that at the end we have a consummate good heart. So that's the second manifestation of goodness. The first manifestation of goodness is in the mind itself. And the second manifestation of goodness is in the heart. Lev tov. A good heart is a pure heart. Lev tahor, Rabbi Elohim. The third state of goodness in the soul is simply is ma'aseh tov, ma'asim tovim, good deeds. Most often, if a person does good deeds, it's because he has a good heart. But the good deed is something by itself. Sometimes you give tzedakah, charity, and do other good deeds, and it's not coming from a conscious internal state of goodness. It's just a person does something good, so it's definitely considered for him to be a very, very good thing, because it is a good deed. Ha'ma'asehu ha'ikar. What's essential is what you do. So a good deed is something by itself. The flow of the soul should be, ideally, the flow should be from the good mind to the good heart to the good deeds. But these are actually three levels in Hasidut and Kabbalah. The good mind, the good intelligence, is called Muskal, is the Chabad of the soul. The good heart is the essential attributes of the heart, which is love and fear and compassion, mercy. That's the good heart. That's called the Murgash, the emotion of the soul. And the good deed is the Mutpa, is the actually the instinctive level of the soul. The Jew, his instinct is to do good things. That's his pattern of natural, normal behavior. So this is another very important interpretation of what the three goods are that we reach when we receive the Torah. So actually, even according to our present calculation, that the year is always chaser, it's always 29 days and not 30 days. But once more, if we count the day of Pesach itself until the day of Shavuot itself, it's actually 51 days. From the beginning of the Sefirah, it's 50 days. If we already said this, that it's 50 days, there are several different ways of understanding the 50 days. The simplest and straightforward way is what it says explicitly in the Torah, that the 50 days are 7 times 7, 7 weeks. That's why the holiday itself is called the holiday of Shavuot, which means the holiday of weeks. It's after counting 7 weeks. So the next day, which is called the all-inclusive Kulel, it includes all of the 7 times 7 is the 50th. But if we, another way of understanding the 50 days, maybe we'll even say another thing it says in the writings of the Arizal, that the 50 days are 5 times 10. That there are 5 different chasadim, 5 different levels of kindness that descend from the Da'at, the essence or the origin of consciousness in the soul to the heart. And each one has 10 different levels to it. Those are called the 50 gates of consciousness, or the 50 gates of 50 gates of understanding. That is divided into 5 times 10. But another way is simply to understand according to the 3 months. This one mitzvah, the mitzvah of counting of the Omer, we're now about to conclude while receiving the Torah. That's essentially, it has to do, we have to conclude this counting in order to properly receive, to be a vessel, to be able to receive the Torah, to be one with the giver of the Torah, as we explained before. So in the month of Nisan, it encompasses 3 different months, Nisan and Iyar and Sivan. The month of every single day of that month, we count the Omer as the second month, the middle month, which is Iyar. The first month, we count the Omer for 15 days, because Nisan always has 30 days, and the Pesach falls on the 15th, the full moon of Nisan. Then we begin the next day to count the Omer, so from the next day, which is the 16th of Nisan, until the 30th. On Nisan, there are another 15 days. And then there are 29 days in Iyar, according to the calendar as it is presently calculated. And then there are another 6 days in Sivan. That's the 50 days, 15 and 29 and 6. So this is a very important division. Also, the days of the country, they all come to the 3 months. Just to see one particular phenomenon that makes this very significant, or taught that in counting the Omer, the days actually add to one another. The second day of the Omer is not just day number two, it's called 2 days. We don't say on the second day that today is the second day of the Omer. We say today is 2 days, meaning that the second day is actually the first day plus the second day. The third day is 3 days. It's the first and the second and the third, which is altogether 6. Actually, the days combine from the beginning to the present day that we're counting. Mathematically, that's called a triangle. Each day is a triangular number. So if the division is the division of the 3 months, and we calculate in that way, so the triangle of 15, the first month of Nisan has 15 days to it, the triangle of 15 is 120. If you count and add together all the numbers from 1 to 15, you get 120, like the 120 years of Moshe Rabbeinu. The second month has 29 days to it, from 1 to 29 equals 435. The third month has 6 days to it, from 1 to 6 equals 21. If we add now all those three numbers together, which are 120 and 435, it's already 555, and then another 21, so the number that we receive is 576. 576 is a perfect number. Sometimes a perfect number refers to a square, a perfect square. It's 24. The 24 hours of the day is 24 squared. So that itself is an indication that this division of the 50 into 15 and 29 and 6 is a very significant and important way to divide the 49 days. But now let's go back to the most explicit division of the Omer and what we now have entered. Today we have entered the last week, the seventh week of the 7 weeks of counting the Omer. So we're now in an immediate state of preparation for receiving the Torah. There are many, many different ways to understand the 7 weeks. The 7 weeks clearly refer or reflect the 7 basic attributes of the soul, of the heart, from chesed, from loving kindness, to malchut, to kingdom. Whoever is familiar with the basics of Kabbalah and Hasidut. So each week is one of the 7 attributes, but there are 7 days in a week. That the attributes inter-include. That's why we say on the first day that we intend to rectify in our soul the loving kindness of loving kindness. And then the second day we say that we intend to rectify the might, the gemura of loving kindness, and so forth, all of the 7 days until the mahut, the kingdom of loving kindness. And then the second week we begin the week of might. Might also means fear and awe of heaven. The third week is the week of Tiferet, which is compassion. The fourth week is active taking of initiative, active trust and confidence in Hashem. The fifth week is Tmimut, walking simply and sincerely, earnestly with God. The sixth week is Yisod, this foundation, the inner property of foundation is emet. Emet means truth, but truth here means the ability to fulfill oneself. Self-fulfillment, self-realization, making the promise to oneself come true. That's the way it's explained, very, very important and deep understanding in Hasidut what emet means in relation to the heart. It means so make it come true. And then finally, Mahut, the inner property of the king of the Kedusha, a holy king like David, David HaMelech, his inner sense, his inner experience is lowliness. He is the king of the people. On one hand, he is above the people, and he commands the people. But deep down in his heart, he feels the lowliest of the people. That makes him a vessel to receive true inspiration from on high, from Hashem, from HaKadosh Baruch Hu, to lead his people in the right way. Right. Now, this is the general understanding of the seven attributes, but one particular understanding is that these seven attributes correspond to the 7 days of creation. Meaning that the first week, the whole first week of the counting of the Omer corresponds to the first day of creation, the day that Hashem created light. Yihyor, let there be light. First there was darkness, and then appeared suddenly light. The second day is the day of the creation of the firmament, which divides between the higher waters and the lower waters. The third day is vegetation. The fourth day is the luminaries, the sun and the moon and the stars. The fifth day of creation is the creation actually of life, of the animal kingdom. It begins on the fifth day, through the fish and the birds. The sixth day is the continuation of the animal kingdom, of animals, of land animals, but the crown, the ultimate creation of the sixth day is man, which is the pinnacle of God's creation of the 6 days. Then comes the seventh day, which, as we said before, this is the whole understanding of Chag Shavuot, that the seventh day is that everything returns, all of that creative power returns to its source, and the experience is the experience of rest, of tranquility and serenity. And so this also we have to understand in the way of heat kalavut, of inter-inclusion. So now we have just began the seventh and final week, the immediate preparation for receiving the Torah, the Simcha, B'Pnimiyut. So let's try to understand the significance in our spiritual service of each day of the week. The whole week is also, just like the giving the Torah, is Shabbos, is Menucha. So this whole week, relative to the Sefirat Ha'omer, to the counting of the Omer, the whole week is a week of Shabbos, a week of the seventh day, because it's the seventh week. And either the whole week is entering a state of tranquility, of rest. And then we can receive the Torah in perfect, consummate state of rest. So what is the first day? The first day is is now we have entered it's actually the 43rd day of the counting of the Omer, the first day of the 7th week of the Omer. That's the light within the rest. So the first day is light, is the creation of light. And the whole 7th week is rest, is Shabbos. If a person is lowly in himself, is at the lowest energy level, that itself is rest. Whoever knows a little physics knows that the lowest energy state is rest. That's a very beautiful, important way to understand the relationship between the inner property of Malchut, which is holiness, and the experience of Shabbat, which is rest and tranquility. So the first day, the day that we're now in, now begun, is the day of light within which I'm in a state of rest, a general state of rest, and I experience in that state of rest, I experience the light of the creation of the first day. Now the light of the creation of the first day comes after the initial darkness. Rest means that everything returns to its origin, as we explained before, in that all of the dichotomies of creation actually begin to unite. When something is created, so it's distinguished, it's particularized, but when it returns to its source, so that the dichotomy and the difference becomes united. But Shabbos is a day of unity. So actually something happens on the first day of the 7th week that the light returning to its source actually becomes one with the primordial darkness. The darkness itself becomes light. What we thought was dark, was black, is actually beautiful, perfect light. That's the experience of light on Shabbat, and actually the night is experienced as day. So Shabbat is a day that the night of Shabbat is full of light. We enter Shabbat, Kabbalat Shabbat, we receive the Shabbat. We sing Zmirot. It's a day of unity. The night and the darkness is full of light. That's the experience, and that's the tikkun, the rectification of the first day of the 7th week of the counting of the Omer. Let's go to the second day. In the second day is the creation of the firmament. So all of the 6 days of creation, which are days of descent, not of ascent back to the source, which is Shabbat. So that the firmament divides, is there to divide and to separate between the higher waters and the lower waters. What are the higher waters and the lower waters? We're taught that higher waters are divine and spiritual pleasure. Water is pleasure. Water gives rise to all forms and types of pleasure in the soul. Higher waters are receiving and experiencing pleasure from divinity. What does it mean to experience pleasure from divinity? If I experience divine providence in my life, that God is here with me. That's a spiritual and it's a divine experience and it's full of pleasure. And I become very, very happy to experience the godliness present in my life, in my day-to-day being. that he said, it says that we have to experience that pleasure of divinity in every breath that we breathe. Every breath is a gift from God. It's all hashkacha, but it's all divine, particular providence. So that's in the simplest way to understand divine pleasure. What are the lower waters? The lower waters are physical pleasures that a person actually is not aware, is not conscious of the divinity within the physical pleasure. He actually pursues the physicality, and by pursuing the physicality alone and not knowing that it's actually spiritual and divine, he separates between that physicality and its true divine inner soul and source. What happens on Shabbos? On Shabbos, it's a mitzvah to have onik Shabbos. The pleasure of Shabbos is to eat good food and to have to know, to experience that all of the physical pleasure is actually divine. It's all divine pleasure. So once more, the severance between the higher waters and the lower waters becomes united on Shabbos. So that's the second day of the seventh week. That's the rakia, the firmament, which normally divides, but it says that the inner essence of the firmament, which is revealed on Shabbos, does not separate and sever and divide, but rather it unites. So the second day, which is tomorrow, is the experience of the unification of higher divine pleasure and lower physical pleasure. Then comes the third day. The third day is already Rosh Chodesh. Is the 45th day of the Omer. Ma, Adam equals 45. Very important number in Kabbalah. When you take Hashem's name, Yud Kei Vav Kei, and write it out full, means that every letter you write out, every letter has a name to it. The Yud and the Hey and the Vav and the Hey, it equals 45. That's the day that we came as one person with one heart. All together we came to meet Bar Sinai, to the desert of Sinai, that there we receive the Torah. So it's a very, very important day. That day is the third day of the seventh week, which means that it's the vegetation. That's what was created on the third day, the essential creation. The third day is the vegetation, the trees and the grass. It's all the vegetable kingdom, it's called, of creation. Within Shabbat, what does that mean? It says that initially Hashem intended that the Tam Eitzo Ketam Piryo, that a tree, the taste of the bark of the tree, or the wood of the tree, and the taste of the fruit should be the same. But on that day, the third day of creation, the earth was unable, as though the earth also has consciousness to it and choice to it, was unable to create as Hashem intended, that the town made so, that the bark and the fruit should have identical taste. But when Shabbos comes, Shabbos is an experience of the future. It's like the growth to come. It's my aim. It's like the Ein Olam Haba. So on that day of Shabbat, so actually the initial intention of Hashem, this is the rest rest of the vegetable kingdom, there's something about the bark of the wood and the fruit, and also that they unite. Shabbos, all of the seventh week is a response from severance and separation, division to unification, and things return to their source. What does that mean in our service of Hashem? That the bark and the fruit both taste the same, taste good. That means that both when we see the Torah now, and the Torah has 613 commandments, we perform the commandments that we consciously know that this is the will, this is the command of God, of the Creator. To us, the Jewish people, the non-Jews have 7 commandments, but we have 613 commandments to perform. That's the fruit, so that every commandment is a sweet fruit. It's tasting a sweet fruit. What is the bark? Bark is all the mundane activity and things that we do in our life. But I say that there's an all-inclusive verse in the Torah that reads, "L'chod rachecha da'eyo." That in all of your ways, and all of the mundane things that a person does, he also has to know and unite with God. If I unite with God with everything that I do, every step I take, whether it's running to do a commandment, whether it's going to work in the morning, or whatever I do, b'chod rachecha, all of your ways, the A will know him. So what happens is that the taste of the mundane, the taste of the bark, becomes identical with the taste of the fruit, which is the performance of the 613 Mitzvot themselves. And that's once more, this is all a reflection of one can only experience these states of unification of each day, the Shabbos of each day of creation, if one is in a state of rest, which we'll explain more in a moment. The fourth day of the creation, the fourth day here, meaning the fourth day of the seventh week, is the creation of the ma'orot, of the luminaries, the sun and the moon and the stars within Shabbos itself. On that fourth day, just like we said, on the third day there was a severance between the taste of the bark and the taste of the fruit. On the fourth day, Hashem intended that both luminaries, the sun and the moon, which are the male luminary and the female luminary, should both be identical, should be the same. But the female, the moon, said that how can it be that two kings have one crown? So God said, okay, if that's what you say, so diminish yourself. That made the moon smaller than the sun, and made the moon only a receptacle to receive the light and to reflect the light of the sun. But the initial intention once more is that both the sun and the moon, the sun and the moon, what are the luminaries? What are the meaning, the spiritual meaning of the luminaries? It's the ability, our ability, the ability of the soul to be a luminary. To be a luminary means to be a teacher. To teach. There's light that's created on the first day, and it's my own experience of enlightenment. But then on the fourth day comes the creation of the luminaries, which is the creation of light for others, light for the world. To be light for the nations. That's the luminaries. But there are two. There's the luminary, which is the sun, and the luminary of the moon and the stars. What's the difference between the luminaries? It's like a teacher and a student. In the present, the present state of being. So there's one teacher, one luminary who is the sun. It says that Pnei Moshe Kinei Hamad, Moses, Moshe Rabbeinu was like his countenance was that of the sun. But Pnei Yoshua, his student, his disciple, Joshua, his countenance was like the with everything that he had, he just received and he reflected the light from his teacher. It says that when Moshiach will come, Techet from the Admamish in our days, now, so the teacher and the student will be one, will be at the same level. It'll actually be one crown. It says, it's no longer one have to say to another, teach me about God, about God. All souls will experience directly God. And we'll all be taught, we're called the Mudei Hashem, we'll all be students of God Himself, and we'll all teach that. Everyone will teach from his soul root. Everyone has a different soul root, a particular, unique soul root, and that will reveal itself. And everyone will teach, will be a luminary from that state. And in that way, we'll actually all be doing the same thing, and thereby we'll all also unify. Because we're all actually teaching one another. That's the Shabbos, the rest of the luminaries, when they return to their initial intention of their creation to actually be one, even though in the present realm, in the state of being, they are two and more than two, because the moon also has all the stars to it at night. Once more, the sun is the day, and the moon is the night, as we said before, on the first day. So in the future, on Shabbat, the night and the day will unite. The night and the very light and the darkness will unite. Then comes the fifth day of the seventh week, the day of the animal kingdom. Animal, even in the English, but especially in the Hebrew, in the original, so kol chai, the expression is kol chai mit no'er. One of the definitions of animal life is like the word animation. That animation means that there's an experience of movement. Movement is also pulse. The pulse is a dual movement that's called Batsova, shall run and return. That's the essence of the life force itself. And movement is also going where you want to go. The person sees something before him, and he wants to reach that destination, that point, and he moves, he goes. And that's the difference between a vegetable, a tree, and a man. So there's a relation between them. But the tree in general is rooted in one place and does not move. But an animal moves freely. And we're taught something even very deep, that the origin of that property of movement, that's called Chaim Mitnoea, is actually in the consciousness of the mind, or in the thought process. That the thought is always on the move. The expression is "Hamachshava meshotetet tamid," that one's thought is always moving and changing from one state to another state, from one thought to another thought. Now we might think that thought is the property of man alone, but no, the thought is the property of every, of the whole animal kingdom, of all living things. On the fifth day of creation, the two forms, the two life forms that were created were the fish and the birds. What do they have in common? Why were they created together? Because both of them swim or fly. That's that when a fish swims in the sea, in the water, so that water is the medium. That medium in Hebrew is like, is similar to the medium of air. There's air and there's water. That's why the verb to move in the water, to swim and move in the water, and the verb to move in the sky and to fly in the sky, of birds is the same word in Hebrew, it's lashut. That the fish is shot by mayim. He swims and moves freely in the water, and the bird is shot by the air. And that word shot is the same word, the identical word that we just said before, the movement of thought. They actually both have thought to them, because if you have destination and you want to reach a certain destination, so that means that you have thought, that you're thinking to reach some point. You also have an experience of time. Now I'm here, but I want to be there in another few moments. Asura mikan, the sham, just like Moses at the burning bush. He was not here, but he wanted to be there. In order to see the miracle, the great miracle of the bush burning and not being consumed. And so that is actually the deeper meaning of the fifth day. It's movement within the thought process, and physical movement itself. And all of that movement takes place on Shabbat in a state of rest. And we think that rest is not movement. Am I in a state of rest? Why not? I'm not moving anymore. No. A person can move naturally, natural flow of movement in a state of tranquility and rest and serenity. It doesn't have to be stable in one place. He can move in his thought. On Shabbat, the thought continues, it even moves faster on Shabbos than on a day of the week. So to move in a state of rest, of perfect rest, is actually the inner meaning of the fifth day of the seventh week of the counting of the Omer. We said that thought is not the particular attribute of man. What is the particular attribute of man, who is the pinnacle of creation on the sixth day? His attribute is speech. Speech is communication. To express myself to another for the sake of unification. In Hebrew, to speak is also an idiom that can mean to unify, actually to cohabit with one's spouse. It's also called speech. Speech is unification, is communication. So there is definitely some primal form of communication between birds, between other living forms. But essential communication is unique to man. Here, Adam le nefesh chayim is an explicit verse in the Torah that man became a living soul, and the translation of that phrase, living soul, is ruach mala, speaking spirit. On Shabbos, it says that the koshi itiru daber afilu b'divrei Torah b'Shabbat. The sages, it was difficult for the sages to allow one to speak even words of Torah on Shabbat. Because just like Hashem rested from his speech of the 10 sayings of creation, so we also have to emulate HaKadosh Baruch Hu and rest from speech. That's why Shabbos is a day, actually, it's a day of singing. Of singing to Hashem, singing without words. A deep song is one with above words. But that singing itself is called Ta'amim Mikra, just like the cantillation notes of the Torah, the song of the Torah. So even the singing itself is a tranquil state of speech. So actually on Shabbat, even though it was difficult, it says, for the sages to allow speech, even the speech of Torah on Shabbat, but in actuality, they did allow, and it's permissible, it's a mitzvah to teach Torah on Shabbat, especially Ravad Ravim. The high point of Shabbat is Mincha, is the end, towards the end of the day of Shabbat. That's the day of teaching Musar, Haskel, and Hasidut, and Kabbalah. All the secrets of the Torah are revealed at that time. And they're revealed through words. So words of Ta'amim. There's words which are actually song, which is song about speech. But in the form, it's the highest level of speech itself. So that is also the tranquility. It's as though I'm talking, I'm speaking, but I'm not speaking. I'm speaking effortlessly. Now we're coming to the essence. That Shabbos is the rest of Shabbos, does not mean that you don't do anything. It means that everything that you do is without effort. It's spontaneous. It's natural. Now we come to the seventh day, the final day of the counting of the Omer, which is the Menucha Shabbat Menucha, the rest within the rest. The ultimate perfect resting of rest. Sometimes we would need to rest within rest. And so sometimes the person rests, he goes to rest, to sleep, because he's very tired, and sometimes he even makes an effort to rest. But to rest within rest, this means that it's perfect, effortless state of rest. That's the 49th day of the counting of the Omer. And actually, this 49th day includes the whole week, just like Shabbos includes the whole week, the Shabbos of the Shabbos. That means that the teaching of all, everything that we now taught, is that all of the states of creation, all of the days of creation now are achieved or become effortless. Just perfect, we call it Muda'ut Tivit, perfect natural flow of consciousness. And then when we reach that, then we're ready to receive the Torah. Shadchu the Alma b'Shabbat Nitna Torah. We're ready to receive the Torah on Shabbos, which is once more the performing of Hashem's will in a state of tranquility and serenity. So may we all merit to receive the Torah anew, and to receive the Torah in this way that we've now taught, and to receive the Torah from the mouth of Mashiach himself, that will teach us a Torah chadashah amitit, they say anew, a new and deep dimension of the Torah, and then make us all achieve actually his own very state, as we said before. There will be no longer a need for teacher and student, because all of us will directly know Hashem. That's the ultimate purpose. Notice means to be united with Hashem at every level, all of the 13 actually levels of the soul. So much love, be chag sameach, be happy receiving the Torah, Kabbalat Torah. We should receive the Torah b'simcha, with joy, and with innerness, to internalize all of the words and all of the teachings of the Torah that Hashem gives us in His love, in His ultimate love for us. And we have to return our love to Him. So once more, Chag Sameach.